Thank you so much, everyone, for attending our webinar. This presentation is being brought to you by the Society of California Archivists Education Committee. And my name is Adrienne Story, and my co-hosts are Mallory Fernier and Christine Kim. And thank you so much for joining us for this ongoing series of web-based webinars, workshops, and training sessions offered through SCA. Today's session will be focusing on Liberated Archives for Black Lives. I'd like to introduce our presenter. Teresa Rayford is the founder of Don't Shoot Portland, a Black-led, community-driven nonprofit in Portland, Oregon, that advocates for social change in the spaces of racial justice and law enforcement accountability. Don't Shoot Portland has been a leading force in the Black Lives Matter movement and protests for racial justice in Portland since 2014. Since George Floyd's murder and the following uprising, Teresa has been on the forefront, filing a class action lawsuit against the city of Portland and suing the Trump administration for the federal response of those defending the general populace's right to protest. Don't Shoot Portland also published an in-depth report on riot control agents in June, illustrating the irreparable harm caused by RCAs during the COVID-19 respiratory pandemic. Don't Shoot Portland has been archived into the Library of Congress as a significant documentation of anti-racism work in American history. Before we get started, we have a few housekeeping points. For one, during the presentation, we're going to mute your lines. And if you have questions along the way, please send them through the questions box to all participants. We will be recording today's session, and we'll be circulating a link to all of you after today. So let's get started. You're muted, Teresa.
That's good. Thank you. I needed a do-over. I'm excited about this. Thanks so much. And I'm hoping that with everything that's happening in the world, that the people in this industry realize how impactful your work has been to the current environment. I believe that, and I had to write it down, I said the history of this country influences current election and even the choice of VP. And I believe that full-heartedly because we had time during the quarantine last year during the spring leading up to the murder of George Floyd to kind of reflect on our country and the history behind the disparities, the inequities, and a lot of the uprisings that happened. We had a chance to kind of research what the goals of those organizations were, including my organization, and why it was so important for us to keep on moving forward for our fight for equal rights and social change. A lot of people believe that during the Obama administration that America had made changes in racial equity that could influence a new generation to be more engaged, more influenced, and more inclusive. But when we elected Donald Trump as our president, I think that the response from people that didn't believe that we were still in a position to maintain the status quo in a way of upholding white supremacy, that framework and that design was more than a reality for a lot of us. And over the last 4 years, I think the calculated return to history, the calculated strategy of organizing around policy and why it was influenced, that is gonna give us a channel moving forward. So thank you all for being here. Thank you for providing this platform to me. And I don't know if I should read the chat while I'm doing this, but I'm gonna go forward. So Don't Shoot Portland is an organization that I started in response to my nephew's murder, but I did it after the death of Michael Brown and the Ferguson uprisings in 2014 because of an arrest that happened. I believe at the time of my arrest that I was arrested not because of the activities that I was doing as a community activist or a protest organizer, but I thought that it had a lot more to do about how I was educating the community that was showing up for these protests. And what that means to me is that I was showing them the history of Portland in what communication through art. we were using like media, we would edit, we would blow up big giant newspaper articles from the 1980s and the 60s, showing inequities that were still being spoken about now. And so a lot of that is what I believe made them target me as an activist because of my relationship to not only community information and history, but also access to the City of Portland's archives, records and management, archives in universities and museums, archives in education centers, elementary schools, their district offices, using that information to show the framework of the inequities between the school, the prison pipeline, and using that as a movement to get people to show up in protest, but also to demand audits, which we added and received. And so using our bodies and our protests and archives to kind of manage a communication, to build accountability through these processes that we know are ineffective and also violent, that it motivates me to do more. And so we're here in 2021 and we're looking at this election that just happened. And again, my opening statement was that history dictated the outcomes of this election because we got to see ourselves. And if anybody realizes that we're squarely still in the middle of where we were in the 60s, it's this industry, the historians, the archivists. And so my job as an activist is to find out more ways to have access to the things that you have access, digital archives, original archives, the process of preservation, space for sharing, what that looks like. And so that's what I do. For an example, this year when we did our MLK March, we created our own paper. And I would have been showing you the file, but my other computer is still uploading. But we made a newspaper that we call the Three Letters from MLK, and we turned it into a poster that people could use. But it's MLK, the Three Letters, and the letters that are contained in it are letters from Frederick Douglass, Martin Luther King, and John Lewis's last letter. So I'll show you the dates on those. We use this as a souvenir copy from our Reclaim MLK protest, and we made sure that we put that information on there as well, but intentionally giving it to children and their families at an MLK march, we also gave them the directives to do research on the authors and to kind of really create a connection of how they feel today and use different mediums such as video, art, writing their own stories, using blogs, pictures to kind of share how they feel and what their letter to the current establishment would look like. And that, you know, it's not just a project for us, it's a way to get them interested in doing more research because intentionally as an organization, you can see on my wall in the back, there's tons of books and information. We give those books to children, but we also give them assignments to report back to us how they receive those books. And that's one of our ways of trying to engineer an interest in the industry of archivism or archives and history and anthropology, because I believe that we need to understand what has already happened in order to dismantle it and to educate a generation to move forward for social change. Hope that makes sense. In the past, different ways that we've established community engagement is through memory. We had this big flood like the one they had in Katrina back in the 1940s here in Oregon, and was called the Vanport Flood. And about 9 years ago, we sat down with survivors of that flood, people that were in their 60s and 70s that experienced that flood. And we talked to them about how they felt. And it was incredible because even people with Alzheimer's, when they were able to see images from that time period, which we had on the computers and we were able to use on big screens, they were able to recite and remember that entire day or whatever circumstances were happening there. And we intentionally had our elders in the same spaces with the youth and their parents so that they could document it, process it, and then reconnect with the elders and their families after getting this information so that they could build the narratives for the people that they love and have their story on the record. And the people that attended these type of events, which we hosted at coffee shops and parks at the time, were all ages with all different types of ways that they showed up. And that was important to us because with our history and with storytelling and documentation, every voice matters in what that looks like. And one of the biggest goals that we wanted was to get people to go and start digitizing their photo albums. Because 9 years ago, one of the things that I realized in activating and organizing was that so many things were being shared on social media that I thought maybe that if we weren't sharing those things, or if we weren't printing up these documents, if we weren't printing up these pictures, if we weren't documenting these moments outside of social media, that when those social media pages disappeared, like MySpace did, that we would also lose that information. It had also occurred to me that people couldn't remember things as much either unless they referred to their social media, which was really scary for me and really made me kind of focus in on the storytelling aspects and getting books into the hands of children, because I wanted them to start journaling so that if they had that memory hiccup where they couldn't remember what they did yesterday or last week because they had already posted it, that they would be intentionally keeping those details of their lives somewhere where they could kind of build on to them or remember them or use them, because I think that our experiences are still useful. So yeah, social media, memory dialogue, we would create panels, we would have people of all ages on different panels, and we would discuss like police brutality. In March of 1981, my family, my grandmother owned a restaurant called the Burger Barn. And I found a VHS tape that my uncle had captured when he was 17 years old at the time. But he had captured all of the news stories for like a whole year surrounding this incident that happened where the Portland police had dumped 7 possums off on the steps of my grandmother's restaurant, a soul food restaurant. He had gathered this information, had all these videos, and I ended up, you know, in what, 2011, 2012, using that information and sharing it with Portland State University, sharing my oral history and memory of the moment, but then using that same platform to kind of engage our community and what they remembered. I would share different pictures or video clips on Facebook, for instance, and so many people in the community say, oh my goodness, I remember getting chicken there. I remember working there. I remember going there to borrow money or to hang out or whatever. Their memories, their shared memories, started giving us even more access to documentation and really brought clarity of the events to me, because I hadn't been misinformed or I didn't remember, because maybe at the time, being a 10-year-old, your memory, the things that you witness probably aren't the same as what you remember when you're in your 40s. So being able to use the information that I gathered from the VHS by digitizing it and sharing it with the general public and getting more information, it gave me more allies in the documentation and narrative building that was necessary for us. It'll be 40 years since that incident this March, and I'm already trying to build on the last 10 years of work that as a community we brought together so that we can build some more experience to get more documentation. And I'm saying that because it's very important for communities and not just media resources and educational facilities to share these stories and to document them. We might not want to give all of our stories to our local county libraries or colleges. We might want to be able to share these stories also with our children. And so it's important to start talking about what happened. What we're learning right now in history is that because we're coming to terms with so much of the inequities that have happened to Black America, that our memory and how we felt at those times that we had regarded them as shame, we had been embarrassed, we had felt because of the way that society sees us and the way that we're projected in media when things like, you know, the possum incident happened and the police said it was a prank. So why should these people be mad if it's just a prank? At the time, that was something that, you know, if you're upholding white supremacy, it's reasonable to make those statements. But now, since we're still discussing them in 2021, we can see the unreasonableness of that. We can see the violence in that. And I think for those that experience that, it's a time for them to exhale because they've had to hold on to that trauma during that time. So again, archiving and liberating the archives and sharing and using them as an educational tool is very important because it does liberate everyone that had to experience those situations in time. some other stuff. So I just have to say a disclaimer, my other computer is still uploading and it has some of my presentation. So if there's any questions, let me know. another way that we were able to use history and archives to organize and activate in our community is we connected with artists. One of my favorite artists that we connected with was Isaka Samsudeen, who is a muralist here in Portland that has been an educator and, you know, working in our city to kind of liberate our minds for Black history and for our futures. Since he was a child, he started making art when he was 7 years old. And the reflection of his artwork was in the people that he saw every day in life. And so a good friend of his, which was Arlene Snitzer, who is an arts patron of the arts here in Oregon, has, you know, symphonies and all kinds of different spaces available to the community. But she literally worked with our organization to create an 18-month calendar for Black history that contained Isaka Samsudeen's artwork. And these were murals and paintings that he made because of his experiences in Portland, the death of his brother by the Portland police, images of his brother as he painted them, you know, not in death, but in life. The death of his brother by a white supremacist here in Portland, those times, those social interactions, and who he was as a child, sharing those moments, but also bringing us into the future with the notes and his experiences. Having that in an 18-month calendar and being designed as an art piece, but knowing that it was a communication piece to literally get people to research, not just to acknowledge information, not just to have something where they can say, oh, you know, this happened on this date, but to kind of feed into their interests so that they would be, you know, kind of inspired to continue to learn more or to document themselves in some sort of way. That was a very substantial and meaningful project that our organization was able to do. And the fact that Isaka had experienced gun violence and police brutality and white supremacy in his family, it helped us bridge that communication with the bigger community that rejected the fact that we were protesting, that might have seen the fact that we were protesting as something violent or underwhelming for change. It showed that that connection was a necessity in order to communicate the action of change, because you can look at art and you can reflect on it, but if there is a determination to insist that there's a demand to action, we actually were able to develop and build that, and we see what that looks like. Someone is asking me, how was the collaboration with Isaka realized? What role did the archive play in the art that he developed? And this is great. And it tells me to answer live or type the answer. I'm just going to answer live. Isaka was doing installations at the Multnomah County Library at the time. And one of our volunteers that organizes with our MLK March had contacted me and said that Isaka wanted to do an art project with his, he wanted to create this calendar, and that he couldn't find anybody to help him like build the format or get the funds to make it happen. And we didn't have the funds at the time to do it, but I know that because we had engaged with art and we were doing social justice and we had recognized Isaka's art throughout our city. For us, it was like, whatever we can do to channel our network to help uplift his art, we know that by channeling and centering his art, that everybody would wake up around him and support his art again. Because sometimes we forget about people. And so we did that in protest. We brought, you know, thousands of people to one of his murals for MLK Day, and it became the front page of everybody's newsletter when they put out their quotes about Dr. King. And it kind of conditioned everybody to want to support him. And since we had already developed a platform, which was the calendar that we were telling people that was going to be released in June, the Juneteenth calendar, it literally created a circumstance where we got the funding through the Arlene Snitzer Foundation. We got the printing through another business that donated printing, a large amount of it. And we had the network that could buy these calendars, including institutions that bought them by the case so that they could be given out and put on a platform for him. And what that did, because Isaka is not a corporation, he's a community member and he's an artist, his prospects of work and information, it was just important. It was very important for us to share that with our community. So we were able to do that in partnership with the Community Action Plan. And can we also discuss the affiliation with Library of Congress? Also, yeah. So we've been putting a lot of our information on social media, our programs, our workshops. We were doing live streaming for like the last 7 years when we were going to citizen review committees and different engagements with the city of Portland to kind of make policy change happen. So when we, what's going on, Coco? I'm sorry, I'm babysitting at the same time. So when we would do this, that information would be on Facebook, it would be on Twitter, it would be on Instagram, and we would use hashtags. And we ended up getting like tens of thousands of people to start using the same hashtags we were using to kind of archive their experiences working with us. And we would create those narratives, ask people to write opinion editorials. We would do countless events. And I think that the engagement of those events on social media, that it created the algorithm that put us at the top, you know, for social justice, arts and activism, education. And so when we got the letter from the Smithsonian, it was just basically letting us know that they had, that they were gonna archive all of those digital assets because they felt that they were an education necessity for what's happening. And I don't know in what way, I've been contacted by different archivists that are connected to the actual person who made this choice for us. And at some point when we're not protesting or filing lawsuits, I'll make time to kind of connect with them and find out how we can support that. We also have our work at the City of Portland's archives, but only in spaces where they're sitting on shelves so that we can continue cataloging it. Let's see what the, how do you think traditional archives can work better with community organizations like yours? Archives or archivists? I think that because of the things that we're doing, when we started using the archives and people knew we were using the archives, it kind of created a barrier against the violence and the hate and the discrediting of our movement, because we had solid evidence of the things that we were stating. We had information and research that was not only on the record, but it was a part of what we were doing. We were getting people to come to City Hall and we would show people like, look, in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, people would go to City Hall and this is what they would say in their testimony. And these are the policies that were being put in place. And these are the situations in society that were happening that were influencing them. And so when we were able to do that, especially around the Possum incidents, sharing old newspaper articles, sharing letters that were sent to city council members, sharing petitions, and the names on those petitions, being able to bring that information to people that hadn't been, you know, that they knew that it might have happened, but they hadn't been that connected to the information as a resource, that kind of created a circumstance where they were like, well, we have to be considerate of these people because this didn't just happen. You know, these circumstances around discrimination and police violence aren't new. You're showing us stuff from the 80s, you know, and that is precipitating things, you know, from the 90s and even before, you know, in the 60s and the 50s. I mean, it's an ongoing, when you're, you know, just looking to news articles is not enough, but it's a way to go forward into the research. So I'm just continuing to expose that research, sharing it, making flyers and posters out of it. I've used archival images to make posters of our community so that people, you know, that probably aren't concerned with protests or social justice or Black Lives Matter can stop and look at it to be curious and then see some kind of matter of need for them to be engaged in social activism and whatever that image contained outside of just the image. Even just sharing the information of the caption a lot of times activates someone to be less inconsiderate of a protester because it's like, oh, there's evidence. And I'm always telling people that when we go to protests or if we go to make a record, which in my opinion, it's a testimony when you grab the bullhorn. It's a testimony when you're on the mic. It's a testimony when you're in City Hall or, you know, any kind of space where you can document what your redress is. But we have to share that those testimonies happened before because sometimes people need that. And I didn't know if I had any more questions, but no more questions. So some of the people that we, oh, okay, let me see. Okay. Can you also discuss, not that same one. Oh. Some of you spend on petitioning, protesting, and advocating versus researching. Oh, I spend the majority of my time researching and preserving information. I'll make a document that takes probably 5 minutes and send it to my lawyers and ask them and our board to make it make sense for the petitioning, and we'll continue. But the research and advocating is and preserving is just is constant. I have kind of like a photogenic memory, so I file information like I'm containing it, like I need to contain it. I need to know the who, what, when, where, why, and how, even if I'm about to advocate for someone. And I document that not to share it with other agencies, but so that we can kind of see the trends in what we're responding to and how those responses are effective or not effective, or what we need to do in our agency to create more resources around becoming more effective. Because we know that our work as social advocates for, you know, social change won't change, it won't go away, and we don't want to be the only ones doing it. So when we're working with youth and families, we literally use the way that we advocate and the way that we research as a tool to share with them so that they can become, you know, the product that they need and out advocating for themselves. So I think the petitioning and protesting is, we don't have to spend as much time. We have such a big network that we send it out and then people use that information and they literally create their own movements. I hope that answered the question, Sierra. Have I had any negative experiences with archives or other institutions that steward history or education, areas where relationships could improve? In the state library here in Oregon, a librarian had found that we Black people in Portland were filed under thug criminal, and I believe that person was let go. I was working also with the Secretary of State's office on audits because a lot of my research and the things that I'm doing in the archives, I'm using them so that I can kind of build framework to quantify issues that we're dealing with, and I seek audits to kind of redress those issues. And I realized that when the bodies of government change and those administrations change, your allies also change. And so I think that for the archivists and the people that are doing that administrative work, I'm kind of identifying people in communities that are a resource for your agency or need access to these resources, advocating for us so that it doesn't matter whose personality is in there, that there's always going to be space for inclusivity or access. I think that's very important because when I first started bringing people to City Hall to go to the auditor's office to get information, they never knew that that space existed for that need. Even going into, you know, the archives, the City of Portland archives, it was like a field trip, taking people in there and showing them digital assets that could help them retrieve information that was important to them. Multnomah County and how they share information intentionally. There's no mandate for them to go out in a community to do it, but they do kind of bring in people like Isaka and like myself to do presentations, but they could do more if you ask me. The Library Foundation paid for me to do a Liberated Archives with the Multnomah County Library, and I had to end that relationship because of the way I was treated by library staff. And these weren't, you know, these were people I thought should and could be my allies because they look like me. But I think that the issues that they have to deal with and working in these institutions that want to be a resource but don't want to be political or don't want to seem like they're taken aside, which information is just information. It's just access to facts. That personal disadvantage that that human person feels is like a problem. So they need to like advocate for information to be accessible, not how they feel about it. What are your thoughts on archives collecting both protest and counter-protest activities? Yes, I do believe that archives should document, because this is, let's say that I started protesting 10 years ago. And at the time that I started protesting, when people would talk about marching or singing those hymns, any of those things, I would reject it. I'd be like, we're not Dr. King. We're not going out there. The dream was what I remembered, him protesting. To me, the way that it was retrieved, I went to Martin Luther King Middle School, I mean, elementary. I went to Harriet Tubman Middle School, and then I went to Jefferson High School. And that's shameful right there. But the thing is that we didn't know that Dr. King was as radical or was as much of a human rights activist as he was. We didn't consider that he was assassinated for his actions. I think that the way that he was taught to me before I started experiencing his life through my work, that he was this soft, fragile creature that, you know, the people loved and paraded with him because he was fighting so hard for all of us to love each other. And that wasn't what was happening. He was literally saying Black Lives Matter. And he was doing it knowing that he was exposing himself to violence, and he expected violence. Nonviolent direct action was the expectation of violence. And so knowing that and harnessing that for the last couple of years that I've been doing the Reclaim MLK here in Portland, I see the difference between people that just protest without understanding the indoctrination of the nonviolent direct action. And it's because they didn't learn that. It's easy to kind of redirect their actions because there's no framework that literally tells you actually who Dr. King was and what he was doing, unless you're like me and you're researching and finding like the Meet the Press interviews or some of his speeches online. That's why we intentionally, you know, published a letter from Birmingham, because we want them to know, like, you're not doing anything any better than Dr. King. You're not moving any faster. We're still where we were. The world has to be motivated to make action happen consistently. And these are what the actions look like. The documentation of that is important. Documenting where we're not making or achieving those goals is important, because we need to be able to research one another. The thing with social media and the uprising of the Ferguson movement is that we, when Mark Brown died and we were all on Twitter, and then we all got onto social media on Facebook and everything else, we were able to kind of like share our experiences in our communities without everybody else in the world knowing it, unless they were in our event pages. And that made us strong because we didn't have to reinvent those wheels. And it was a combined focus for action. Right now, it's not so much that people are kind of in chaos because they don't know who's saying what or why. And so I think the preservation of our voices kind of will let us know in our debriefings that, hey, these are things that we can work on. And for the next generation, they can see that as well. They need it. It's like a blueprint, a playbook. Okay, so I'll read these since everybody can't see it. I'm sorry. So you've touched on some already, but can you share more about your broader strategic understanding of how you are, of how your archival work fits in the movements fighting police brutality and racism? What are your big dreams and goals for this work? Lastly, what are your recommendations to oral historians wanting to support grassroots movement work? What are my broader strategic understanding of how you're... I think that it just helps document what our movement is about. Like, the more that I learn about like Malcolm X and Dr. King from actual archival documents that I can research, their own notes, their own writings, some videos and audio, I'm out learning what I was presented, what was produced to me through digital media on TV, intentionally, right? And so it's making me a better movement organizers, making my work the framework is more substantial and effective because we have the evidence. Without the evidence, you're just saying that something is harmful, or you're mad about something. But when you actually have documents that you can create a narrative with and create an op-ed or an event panel dialogue, it adds that that information that you need to kind of make your case. And really, we've been making our case into courtrooms and filing lawsuits, and building it that way so that there's substantial information for anyone else that also wants to make their case. Some of the biggest dreams and goals that I have for our work is kind of like publishing how we do our work, our programming that we provide to children, because we've developed it with family members from all ages. Like, we were working with 80 and 90 year olds, we're working with 70 year olds, and we're working with 5 and 6 and 10 and 12 and 25 year olds, and having that bridge of community communicating and how they share so much to develop how we educate, that's important. And I don't want it to be lost with time. I want to be able to document it and share it with other communities. So our goal is publishing our work, not just for archival information in Library of Congress, but for communities so that they can use it. And I would say that historians that want to support grassroots movement work need to educate more brown people in their communities that are connected to the archival documents, like photo albums, scrapbooks, people, and bringing them into this this industry. Because when I think about like some of the narratives that I've heard from the Library of Congress before I even knew about what all this movement work was, I used to read, narrative from formerly enslaved people. That getting that information from Black people that share those dialects and those experiences, I think adds additional layers that we need. Having that person document their information without additional context that comes from people that shared that experience kind of keeps us in a space where we're being entertained. And I don't want to be entertained. I want to be educated. I think a lot of people do. Greetings from Atlanta. That's where my sister lives and one of my other board members. What has your experience been like accessing university archives in Portland? Are there items of interest in university archives that our general public has knowledge of and easy access to? Thank you kindly. I started going to the archives at Portland State University in 2011 when they did an oral history on me as a civil rights leader. And I don't think I was doing too much, but I felt that because I had like built a platform for being a person that speaks out, that they just grabbed me and said, hey, my students need to talk to you. And for me, that's kind of frivolous because there's a lot of people that are doing this work, a movement work, that probably aren't getting television time and probably aren't shutting down streets that need to be contacted. And I think that when we have that university's resource, that we also should develop a resource that gets those people into the community so that they don't just have to count on somebody that somebody knows. And Portland is so racist that a lot of the, it's so bad, that people just like, they pick somebody that they know and that person's platform is elevated because of that relationship. It's like tokenizing, we call it. Exploitation, Black exploitation, but it's ridiculous. And I think that if we really want to help communities, that will bring resources to help them learn how to use those resources for what they want to use them for. I want to have a place that we don't have to have our stuff in the universities at some point, our own community archives. And I would like it to be funded just like the museums are, so that we don't have to have stolen products in them or information. I'm trying to make sure I started getting a whole bunch of questions, so I'm trying to make sure I didn't lose one. That was the Atlanta one. How can professional, I think I just answered that same question, but how can professional archivists best help any communities? Oh goodness, these questions. Is it better? Okay, so I guess somebody's deleting them. Sorry, y'all, because I'm just trying to read through them and they just keep going up. How can professional archivists best help any community preserve its history? Is it better to have established institutions that take in materials from the community or help the community create its own archive? Yeah, help the community create its own archive. One of the things that I was trying to discuss with Arlene Snitzer and really a lot of the art people and institutions here in Portland before she had passed away was retrieving guardianship over what we call the Albina Arts Center, which was a Black administrative building that housed arts and education. We wanted to rehabilitate the building, preserve the building so that it could become a public archive space for the Black community, where not only that items would be archived, but where there would be educational trainings and programs available to show what that preservation looked like. And it could be some type of like intake process, like what we did on the workshops that I used Liberated Archives for with the library. Bring in your photo albums, we'll teach you how to digitize them, we'll show you how to, you know, preserve them in acid-free folders and mylar plastic and just all the different things that people in the industry know. But in my community, it's like, oh, I got them in the box and they up in the attic and they're getting ruined and we will never have access to them in a safe way again. And so having those spaces in communities to me seems like a necessity, especially when we know that we've all started saving things online and that the archives we have in our homes are becoming less and less relevant unless someone tells us that we need to document or keep them, or unless a funeral happens and then we all look for an old picture. But I think that we should be intentionally building those spaces so that we can start documenting history. That way it's more accessible. Okay, so aside from the materials and assistance, connecting with archival collections, are there ways archivists support preservation through technological support, such as server space, preservation of files, expertise, and providing digitized materials for rapid sharing? Thank you for your work. Yes, definitely. One of the things that I realized as an activist, when I want to document everything, but there's social movements that are happening, we don't get the time to document. And so a lot of information that's online, I used to intentionally put links to articles, tag people and things like that so I could go back and retrieve that information. But what I learned was a lot of stuff was taken offline pretty fast too by different agencies. And some agencies would go out of business or some bloggers would just delete the information. And a lot of times when you're intentionally trying to save this information so you can go back, it's really important. And so I think that people in your industry, that if you're able to kind of massively capture those things and have them, that people would be able to retrieve them later. I think that the cost of holding the bandwidth sometimes might be a factor. So maybe putting funding out there that provides that so that it would be preserved for future use. There's so much information that's happening rapidly because of social media. So I know it's hard, but I think we can achieve those goals because it's a necessity to know what's happening. It helps us. Files and all that, yes. I would like to collect photos of local protests, but I'm concerned about protecting the identity of the protesters from law enforcement. Do you have any suggestions on how I could collect those images, or should I not? Yeah, you should not. It's not okay, unless that's what your intention is. I noticed in 2014 or 2015 when the police would come out with the selfie sticks and record us, and I called them out and said, hey, are you violating and investigating my freedom of speech? Do I need to sue you? What's going on? And I think those things need to be worked out in courts, but I've realized that they are documenting everything and then they're trying to create cases against people where there aren't any cases. They're using it to kind of terrorize people and intimidate them from showing up to protest. And I think that our freedom of expression is important. What we've acknowledged to people that show up at our protests is that capturing the sound and transcribing the sound and not having names is a good way. I've listened to some protest audio and it was amazing to hear the sound of our movement and the sound of voices, not just speeches, but just the dialogue happening amongst us. It's pretty amazing. Take pictures of signs, document the police's involvement, because a lot of people, if you're on the right side of history, if you look at the things that the freedom fighters went through, John Lewis, Dr. King, everyone that was in the Selma, you're looking at the attack dogs, you're looking at the water hoses, you're looking at them snatching people, you're looking at them hit the batons. You're not really concerned with the faces of the people holding the signs and bullhorns. The main concern was the violence that was taking place and how it made all of us feel and how we as society allowed that and literally had mandates available so that it could happen. Have fees for public archival resources been an obstacle to research? No, because I know so many people in my community that I've been able to buy stamp. And I used to work in the library when I was younger, so I went straight there when I needed everything I needed. I knew the library would have it. But again, everybody doesn't know that. And so they haven't been an issue yet, but that's only because we have lawyers that sue for access to public records also. And we probably need more people to be in that type of position, or we need legislators to mandate that public records are always available at no cost because they serve the public need. Hey Adele, what's happening? That's an interesting thought, having archivists connect with funeral homes and Black communities. Yikes. I just went to a funeral in Brooklyn of a beloved elder, so it's on my mind. Maybe not the best time, but it's when people dig for images. Yeah, the archival information that I get in obituaries, one of the things that made me start researching was researching in our community about gun violence and why the state didn't feel like our public safety was important, was because I noticed that on the funeral obituaries, that there were certain names of agencies that were connected with the cost of the funeral. And so I started my investigation of policy and city partners through that, but then even more so being able to see who's related to who, where they lived, and how to reconnect families that have been displaced because of gentrification. Like, a lot of people didn't realize that, you know, back in the day, grandmas used to have like 15 kids, and those kids, when they left home, they got married, they had families. And when we were displaced because of gentrification and you know, all this monetary value on, you know, like the crack epidemic and everything else, how they monetize all of these different situations. The only way that people even realized that they were related to people were at funerals. And that was a shame. You know, that's really a shame. And I think that that is something that is intrinsic to the Black community. How can professional archivists best help any community preserve its history? It's better to have established institutions take in materials from the community, or help the community create its own archives. Yes, help the community create its own archives and start fighting to get that humanities money back. I know that the former administration took a lot from the humanities. And I think that because social change is happening, that this is the best time to invest in the humanities. So kind of try to partner the archivist community with the arts community so that we could start building that framework of engagement, because we need to start building better tools of getting people in a position to document information and to even think about why it's important. Pushing questions over to the answer tab. Okay, yay. All right, so no more questions. Yay. So yeah, other people that I work with, and I think I've already stated it, lawyers, archivists, documentarians like Adele Pham, libraries, my great grandmother's scrapbooks, using all those different resources has given me way more than enough time to kind of create educational models for the youth based on what has been presented to me, and that works. So I think everybody is an archivist in their own way. We know that lawyers do a lot of research because they want to understand precedent or, you know, different court-related situations, standings. But that a lot of that has helped us in kind of creating, you know, our ask in protest. We look at what's already there and we use that to create our new ask. So, yeah, let's see at least. We still have no questions, so. Yeah. Did y'all want anything else from me? Type of events, materials, community access. Can you share more examples of how you transform these materials into educational materials? Of how you transform these materials into educational materials. Any tips on incorporating oral history, audio, and education? We've had to make different types of material available to the youth. So this is a documentation of this year's protest, and I'll probably send you. I worked with kids to do the illustration, worked with university to do the design work, and they literally made this out of a keynote that I did for the Pacific Northwest College of Art. And it even contains our pictures in front of some panels that we'll be receiving from the Apple Store for preservation. But it's documenting the protests that happened this year and how the community came together to provide mutual aid. And we intentionally made this for our youth so that they could get it at the MLK March. And again, we used art because it's interesting to them. They're like, hey, it looks cute. But when they start reading it, it's information and it actually gives them directives on creating their own mutual aid situations and also to, hi Tressa, can you talk about the partnership work with the Portland Art Museum? Yes, I can. We did Liberated Archives last year around the same time at the Portland Art Museum, and they've been a really good partner in helping us get books that we can't afford because we do residencies with them, and they use their resources to kind of get us in positions with different artists or authors that we wouldn't necessarily have access to as activists. And we've really been able to use that to kind of like offset our cost of document prints, printing documents, getting information, building relationships. They're a credible partner. The fact is that in 2015, I got arrested for protesting. And I believe that the event that we were having was a community art project. And we made it a community art project because we wanted the protest to be accessible for everyone. As you can see, for me, access is a very important thing. So on the day that we were doing it, we were literally intending to talk about art, make art, and express our art on the anniversary of Mike Brown's murder. And they came and arrested me. And this was like the most peaceful protest we had ever had. We were, you know, I think I had a bullhorn in a bike lane. And so I ended up going to jail. I ended up having a 4-day trial. And I wanted to be safe before, you know, I had to go to court. So a year had passed. We were going to be doing the Mike Brown protest again. And because of that arrest the year prior, I was afraid that the experience of the activists watching, you know, someone get hurt or arrested by the police, that was going to harm our communication of social change. And so I stepped up to the art museum and I said, hey, y'all protect art and you're protecting stolen art, and that's not okay. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna demand that y'all provide us sanctuary here, because if we don't have sanctuary to express our art or to express our freedom of speech, I think that it's incumbent upon institutions like yours to create what that looks like. And so we literally took over the art museum for a Mike Brown anniversary event, which we talked about race in America. We had people from St. Louis come out and speak on a panel. We had a big art event in front of the museum, which contained a band and a lot of different activists that came out to perform. And it wasn't funded by the art museum. We literally had got our own funding and did this, but we needed the space, and our only demand was that they don't call the police on us. And so that turned into a whole partnership. It started in 2015, and we literally needed a place that we could be provided sanctuary so that we could address the issues around the murder of Mike Brown and the continued murder of Black people in America by police. Visual aid is great. Who does the artwork? Corey Salter did this artwork, and she's a kid. she's a youth person that did a lot of infographics for us this summer around the LRAD, Know Your Rights, COVID, and different things. And so I wanted to give them the experience to work with the university, because now she's in college in Chicago. But I wanted to not only use her for the protest art, but to also give her this experience to share that art offline with youth at our Children's Art and Social Justice Council. But yeah, I'll go to the youth for it so that they can be paid for their work and so that they could be inspired to continue being activists. Because what I realized when I first started organizing was that people had choices. They didn't get to do everything. They couldn't be an artist and an activist. Someone told them they had to choose. And I think that we're all of those things. And so I keep trying to just find ways to bring the mediums together. When you were showing the book based on your presentation, you said you would be getting art panels. How will you preserve those? Are they going to the Portland Art Archives? Oh, so yeah, the art panels. So There was an uprising we all know about, but the Apple Pioneer store here in Portland had been muralized. People created a memorial on the panels that were put on after the glass was broken during a protest. And the panels became very famous for our community. There were people that had lost their loved ones who were able to use that panel to stage a reintroduction to the lives lost here in Portland. And so Apple had contacted our organization through the Portland Art Museum and through the Oregon Historical Society and said, hey, don't shoot Portland. We'll probably have some ideas about what we could do with these panels. And so we created a conversation and we're working on that. And some of that stuff is not concluded yet, but we will be receiving these panels. And we'll be archiving them, and we'll be utilizing the uprising and the activists and the artists' involvement in that to create information and education programs. So I'm excited about it. It'd be something like this, except for it's going to be focused on that information contained in those panels and those artists' channeling of response. And hopefully I didn't tell y'all something I wasn't supposed to, because, you know, we're still negotiating that, but I did sign the document. So have you thought of, or have you created a guide for archives and community groups that covers how you use archival materials? It'd be wonderful. That's what we want to do. We just haven't found time because the police keep killing people and we have to respond to the work that we're doing. But we keep everything. We have two storages in the City of Portland Archives, filled with all of our documents, banners, information, notes, journals. You have touched on this previously, but what precautions should community members take when working with college archives to create collections that document Black life? Is it possible to have a liberated archive within an institution? I think that the liberated archive in an institution would be a resource of how to archive your documents. I think that being able to preserve them for future use is how we make sure that they're available to other people and not just locked up in an institution that can choose to make them available or not. If that makes sense, I hope I answered the question. But I think they should have spaces where we can go in and just create documents. Some libraries are now available, or right now because of COVID, not available. But they were making scanners available, memory sticks and stuff like that. I think we can go further. I think we can do more. And I think that institutions that can need to make kiosks or models, or at least fund spaces in communities that could be more accessible. Any more questions? We're at 202.
Teresa, we have until 2:30, if you'd like, but it's up to you how long you want to go.
No, I'm good. There's I didn't know if we were all going to talk again with everybody, but I'm going to read David's question real quick. I'm like, we still got time if y'all got questions. Let me see. What the goal of transparency and historical documentation? How do y'all make decisions about when and how to archive while keeping organizers safe, similar to folks taking photos at protests? Do you have any recommendations or suggestions? Internal organizing. So are the materials you are intentionally publishing, or any materials you are intentional about publishing or archiving? So most of the notes, a lot of our stuff has not been shared with people yet. And there's very important reasons behind that, because I'm still like filing lawsuits and appeals and things like that, where we need to have that stuff not be evidentiary. But also some stuff that we have had, we've used for those same reasons. I think that just documenting everything and having a plan for how to hold on to those containers of documents, whether it's the folders, whether you're writing or whatever, I think it's all important. What emails, what I would do, like one time I did a protest at Portland Community College and Senator Wyden was there giving a speech at a town hall. And I intentionally came to that event because I knew there would be a lot of labor movements there, and I wanted the labor movements to realize that the Black Lives Matter movement needed their support because we all had the same values and goals, and that we, you know, we should be working together to kind of make people like our senators see the disparities that are happening. So we did the protest, and what ended up happening after that was Senator Wyden's office contacted us. And so I had some of my like second year law student volunteers sit down with his staff, and they documented everything that we were conversating about. So I'm talking to the staff, and I have these two law students documenting everything that we're talking about. And it ended up being pages of information, and we ended up being able to kind of like follow up on some of the different things that we talked about and readdress those things. And it was very important because you don't want to have these important meetings with these lawmakers or these people that you're trying to have address these inequities without having your own follow-up or without instituting the why. You want to share that resource back with your community, especially if they showed up with you to protest. So a lot of the information that we would document was clearly just to share with the people that we felt were stakeholders in our community. And we would do it through blogs or through our newsletters. We'd say, hey, you know, we did this and that. And again, we would share certain information. We would throw links in there, but a lot of it is too much information. But we know that it's enough for us to keep going back and reconsidering parts of it for use. To me, all of it is just taking a whole lot of notes, and then we'll probably use them in 10 years. But as long as we have the, you know, all of the information for why we made these statements or anything, is more context. How do we get copies of your education materials, mutual aid, or MLK to share with our community members? Good question. We have a mutual aid. We have a link tree that we use. And during the uprisings, we literally, we put all of the documents that we were making and all the artwork that people were sending us on there so that different communities could upload it and use them. And so I saw like our flyers all over the country, and I'll put the link tree in the chat so that it can come to you if my computer lets me without losing out. And then also on our site. I think our website is a whole archive also. And there was a couple of years that I didn't keep it up like we've been recently, but I still have all the documents and everything that we did. And let me go find this Q&A again. All right, so I just put that in the chat. I think hopefully y'all have access to it, but it's a link tree. It just has so much documents. I'll get that copy on the link tree also. It's a little bit off topic, but are you able to talk about your candidacy for board mayor? Well, okay, so yeah, I was watching one of Adele Pham's documentaries earlier, and I think this was before I decided to run, but I had said something about if you stand up for Black people in Portland, then you're never gonna be a mayor. And I wish I'd have watched that before I decided to run again. But no, I ran for mayor because I had voted for Ted Wheeler, and 1 month into his candidacy, he was assaulting our community members because of their outrage at the Trump election. And then, you know, obviously people that were unhoused started dying on our streets, and he didn't have a complex plan. A child named Quantas Hayes was murdered by the police on February 9th. And there wasn't a valid response from his office. He had coffee with the Proud Boys. People got killed on the MAX trains. There was so much like madness coming out of his office, his administration. There was no connection to the community. There was like, I guess I can say no fucks to give to anybody that really had elected him because we wanted social change. All of the things that were happening were so violent and so disturbing that the only way that I felt that I could give hope to so many people that I had, you know, asked to support him using my platform and the people that I knew were motivated for social change was to start looking at not reelecting him, looking for, you know, leaders that had substance that would be able to engage with the community on a level to move us forward. And at a point I felt that I could be that person for our community. And I still, you know, do the work every day, but yeah, I felt that I could be a public servant and utilize the resources and our connections in the community to start allocating and advocating for better policy and you know, fair exchange of human access to resources. Yes. Okay. I'm babysitting from a friend. Okay, so I think you mentioned concern about donating materials to a university archive because they could deny access to that down the line. Could you expand upon that concern and what an archive could do to remove that concern for potential community donors? Well, I mean, even right now with COVID, a lot of people, I don't have access to my archives. I think that I do have some access to the archives, but I can't just sit in there and open everything up and bring in a class and start using that resource. And I think that we need to build those resources in our communities first, because in my state, we don't have a Black museum or African-American art museum or, you know, any kind of substantial educational platform for learning about the contributions of the Black people in Oregon. Or really any people of color. Everything that we see is kind of like a travesty of justice because it was rooted on, you know, genocide and displacement. So I think that when that's your history and the culture that you live in expects that and provides that to you, that you want something that you can have that has nothing to do with that patriarchy system. So that's why my concern is there, is because I don't see evidence that America cares about our history in a way that would help us determine our future. I don't see how it's a component that we can use to kind of generate progress for our people or to address systemic policy that harms us. And I think that's intentional when I talk about things being utilized for entertainment purposes as opposed to educational purposes. That's kind of where I'm getting at. And so when I receive information and when I share that information, I share it from a place of, you know, experience and need for establishing change, not just for informational purposes. And I think that we can get more of that if we have more people in that industry that had those access to resources, but we don't. So we need to start building access in our communities. I hope that answers your question, Nicholas. And so, and if you want to, I'm going to show y'all some more of the panels real quick because I made them really big for Black History Month.
Remember those panels pop up? Oh, yeah. So if I don't make it a big enough issue, people won't pay attention, and I make a big issue out of it. But so since the book is so small. But yeah, that's what I mean. These are the mutual aid panels. Those aren't the ones from the Apple Store, but you can go to the, I would say Apple Store George Floyd panels and probably pull those ones up. But those are the ones that I'm using for the kiddos to get them interested. And hopefully everybody got access to that link tree. Let me see. Oh yeah, Apple Store Mural Portland is the first thing that came up. And I think this is a story about Apple's intention to hold on to their panels, which are way bigger than the ones I just showed you. The ones that we're working with Apple on, we literally talked to someone about putting those up in storage for us so that they'll be preserved. And I believe they put a layering over them. So they haven't, even though people have kept putting more, like they literally got vandalized, but they had put a coating over them to kind of make sure that they weren't disturbed.
you envision community archives being open to the public for research purposes or just for the community itself? Really, I think for the community itself, I wrote a program a couple of years ago called PDX Civil Rights with my friend Tanya Gassard, who's a historian. And it was really centering around the Burger Barn space and what I wanted to do to rehabilitate the building and turn it into a learning center. And I wanted it to be a bank where we could kind of like not deposit our archives, but upload information and really people in a community, Black people that have been displaced. When I talk about like my great grandmother having 15 kids and my grandma having 10 kids and, you know, like those families, wanting to connect, reconnect, like how we do with, you know, the DNA searches in communities. If we had a place where you could go and, you know, put up your grandmother's obituary or something and see, oh, these are her brothers and sisters. This is where they live, or, you know, connect those to city archives or county archives or state archives just for research, education stuff, you know, finding old yearbooks and connecting back with different things like that. I grew up in foster care. So for me, finding friends and reconnecting with people was very important because we moved a lot. And I wish there was a place where I could just be like, you know, what was Maddie, you know, what was she really into before she took care of us? Because as a kid, you remember some heroes and you know nothing else about them. as an archival institution, do you have any suggestions for how you overcome issues of mistrust within the community, especially without existing relationships with that community? Build a standard that doesn't perpetuate paternalism or white supremacy that is inclusive and accessible. I think that when those things are available, that it doesn't, you know, our own personal biases help us just make sure there's inclusion. Get rid of the bias or the person and their bias by creating a system that contains inclusivity and promotes engagement for everyone. I hope that makes sense. Let me see. So how big or small is your team at Don't Shoot Portland? You are all doing amazing work for the cause. Imagine you also have other jobs. Thank you so much for what you've done. I just got hired by Don't Shoot Portland. I've been running it with no salary for the last 10 years, but we finally found a way to get me paid. And so we have hundreds of volunteers. We have a very active board that includes my family members and people in our community that like really care about this work. And so we motivate and activate on a community action plan. Even on our banners, it would say Don't Shoot Portland, a community action plan. And that includes like the thousands of organizers. The little girl I'm watching, because I can't say I'm babysitting her, but Coco is like a lead organizer of the Children's March. She's been marching for like 4 years. The people that connect with our movement are victim survivors of violence. They're people that we advocate for. And it's people in our community that just literally come together to help elevate the issues behind our voices. And so, you know, like I said, archives is very important because it affirms that whatever you're going through and why we're advocating for you, that you're not alone. And I think in sharing that you're not alone by being able to be creative in communicating, that's what keeps us motivated and inspired to keep working. Have any other local Portland institutions or yours archived examples of ephemeral protest materials like those downtown, the Elk signs, graffiti? Not that I know of yet. Some of the artwork is so, like the protests didn't stop. So the artwork that was done on panels was literally covering windows. That we're gonna, you know, if you took it down, probably be busted again. So I don't know. I think the Proud Boys took the Elk and they brought us another Elk or something like that. There's so much going on in Portland right now. It's hard for me to know, but I don't know. I've seen documentation of some of the protests art in the form of calendars. And I purchased some from the youth that took the pictures and made the calendars. I've seen lots of pictures in digital media. I know that we, without, you know, negotiating the terms of receiving the artwork from Apple, that we would not be able to just take them. So there was negotiations in how that happened. But Yeah, it's a hard thing because like we just moved out of our office. So it's like, where would we put it now in storage with everything else? Times are really changing. I think this is a good time, like if institutions aren't able to kind of formally invite people back in, that they need to start figuring out how do we utilize our resources and our industry to kind of start doing that kind of work to help. And not so that they can dictate how it's used, but how they can connect with communities that could probably see usefulness from it. Do you think it would be helpful to have archivists in the field with your group during various activities? Always, always. And I've always tried to provide a platform for archivists in most of our panels and discussions every year, because I always want to remind people that it's important to document everything that's happening, as much of it as they can. And I think what that also does is it gives them like inspiration to communicate in a way that is helpful, so that when they know that we're documenting things as a community, the things that they share as a community, not only on their social media, but when they're out organizing and protesting, is kind of relevant to getting the communication that is necessary for us to dismantle the systems that oppress us. So yes, being out there helps us. And especially if you can document on our behalf, like I was saying, some of the sounds, having that audio when you have people doing oral storytelling, like radio, people that are doing radio, having that sound is a memory connection. It, you know, I remember listening to, I think it was Jen Chavez, who worked with now OPB, but at the time worked with X-ray radio during 2014 protests. And I remember when she played the sounds of audio, I remembered exactly which protest it was, even though there were hundreds of protests that year. I could tell, and there wasn't any, you know, speaker. It was just the people having their conversation, but I was back in that space. And so if I wanted to remember anything else, that audio would help me. And so any way, any resources y'all have, get creative with it, create a new way. But this is the time. There's so much happening in the world right now that archivists should be having the most fun. What are your thoughts on how to change the history taught in public schools on a national level so that all children learn about the histories of? I say take it further than public schools. I think that our history, that we have the resources to kind of create a new social outlet in the world and how we connect with one another. And I think that right now, because of everything that's happening, that we should look at how we can share history in spaces outside of educational institutions. I think that like when I grew up, Kodak pictures and photo albums was a big deal, regardless of who was taking the pictures. I think people did, you know, watch the civil rights movement. They saw the media doing it, and then they were able to bring those tools home and use them for just normal things. I think that as a society, we have to start making, you know, documentation and preservation part of our life, part of our social behavior, and we need more tools. We can't keep using our cameras and social media. Y'all have the tools. You know how to, you know, like my VHS tape, you know, y'all know how to digitize that. You have those resources. The general public doesn't have access to, you know, digitizing VHS. You know, we got records, you know. How do you transfer that information? Why would you transfer that information? But no, I think the archives and the way that institutions are ran, that needs to come home to our communities, and we need to have more and better access and more educational materials, because it's a lot to write, it's a lot to document, and we want to know how people feel, because sharing that will help us move forward. Have you spoken with Black archivists and the burden sometimes placed on us to save and record these stories on our own? Yeah, and that's why those institutions need to put more money in your pockets, and they need to do more outreach. Oh, let me read the question. So have you spoken with Black archivists and the burden sometimes placed on us to save and record these stories on our own with little institutional, let alone emotional support? So many BIPOC archivists are leaving the field because of the systemic colonization baked into these public institutions. And I do know that. One of the reasons that I started doing Liberated Archives was so that I could speak on behalf of our communities to the need for these programs to be developed and maintained and managed and overseen by people from our communities so that they wouldn't be there just for the typical exploitation of Black people during Black History Month. I think we need to institutionalize preservation in our communities, and that the people that already have the burden should be the people that guide us into developing what that looks like. I don't think that the institutions realize that y'all are doing them a major favor, and that they can't afford you already, and that the assets that we need should be identified through you as a resource before it comes to us. I don't like when I make demands on an agency and then everybody around the table is white that is being able to, you know, document what I'm thinking and how I'm feeling and what I want to do, because my information becomes their information. And I've seen that turn into more opportunities for them. And then they'll bring in Black people when it's time to entertain us or to do a show. And that hurts, because I'm like, I wouldn't have had that conversation with you if I would have known that this is going to be the outcome. I want to see my babies get educational assets out of this. I want to see Black businesses and institutions develop because of the need and be supported and centered in their funding because of the need. And it shouldn't be on just one or two people. In my work as an advocate, when I witnessed the uprising after the death of George Floyd, and the fact that so many people, to me, it seemed like they turned Black Lives Matter into a fundraising opportunity. That work came on us. Like, people started being able to elevate their interests in the movement, but the actual work that we do became more work for us. And there's no amount of money that you can pay an agency to take on work that they're not going to be able to do when their values want to make change happen. So I hope that makes sense, that we'll continue fighting. That's why little, you know, agencies like mine, we don't want to do the work, but we don't have people in our communities helping us get the work, and we're losing our communities. We're losing lives. We're losing voices. We're losing stories. And when we participate, and when I did my first Liberated Archives, that was a form of protest for me on your behalf. Because you need somebody that don't have to worry about losing that job. And I hope I don't have to keep doing it, but if I have to, you can count on me in whatever way we got to show up, because our communities need y'all. We're not going back.
Teresa, it's 2:26 and I just wanted to check in. I know we have to stop right at 2:30. So maybe one more question, or you let me know.
Okay. One more question is cool. I enjoy this, so I'm thankful. I hope everybody got to see that link tree, and it kind of has some information in there. I'll have some more stuff on there. You can say hi to everyone. Youth activists.
Hi.
Yeah, she's a community organizer, and she reads a lot. And she documents stuff she writes in her journal. And we're teaching them young, because it should be usual and customary. Thank you all for your work that you do every day. I hope you continue to stand up for Black lives. And if you need to organize, or if you would like a platform to share the work that you're doing, we would love to do that. Can't find the educational material, maybe check out through the meeting. You're not going to find it in the link tree, just images and flyers. The educational material we want to publish, because we just do the work. But it's all on our website, all those different programs. I think there's supposed to be some slides posted later on today from the books that we gave away this weekend or this Monday.
Teresa, thank you so much. I mean, this has been incredible. My understanding is that you had a whole slide deck and that you've really rolled with the
computer wouldn't work.
Computer issues. Thank you so, so much.
Bad with my other computer, so I had to grab the laptop at the last minute. Thank y'all for being patient with me.
We do have There is a survey right after when you log off that we would love for you to fill out. And just thank you so much for sharing your insights and strategies into local preservation of Black civil rights, Teresa. Thank you, Mallory and Christine, for facilitating the webinar. And thanks to all of you attendees who took time to participate in today's webinar. And yes, go ahead and give us your feedback in the survey. And if you have any suggestions for our next webinar, please weigh in.